The year is 303 AD. You've just arrived at the newly constructed Aurelian walls, which serve as a reminder of the Empire's growing weakness. The city had long expanded beyond the old Servian walls, but the Empire was so strong back then that there was no real need to defend it. But then came the 3rd century crisis. The Empire was divided, barbarians invaded, and the plague of Cyprian killed 5,000 people a day. This is why you left the north to flee the barbarians, and like many, seek refuge behind the newly built walls. Travelling along one of the greatest roads of Rome via Aurelia, you may have seen a number of tombs which belong to the rich, lining either side of the road. If you're lucky, you may even see a funeral, which often had professional mourners pulling out their hair, and actors wearing the ancestral death masks of the deceased. But as you continue down the road, expect to pay 2 denarii per mile to the soldiers guarding towns and bridges on the way. Or if you're travelling by wagon, this can be as high as 12 denarii per mile. And I should say that you can only travel by small wagon, because, to protect the roads, it is illegal for a wagon to weigh more than 1,000 pounds. Furthermore, this is not a safe journey. There's always the chance of bandits attacking, or just being pickpocketed by the many beggars on the outskirts of the city. But the greatest danger is malaria, which takes the lives of many passing through the swamps around here. Many believe that malaria is caused by bad air, and you can sort of see where they got this idea from. This is because most of the dead people were just flung into huge pits, sometimes with animals, just outside of the city limits. So if you survive the journey, you will be greeted by a terrible smell. Anyway, as you'll arrive at the city, you'll come to the Aurelian Gate. There you'll see the rich get off their carriages, as it is forbidden to drive carts in the city during the first 10 hours of the day. This is to prevent the narrow streets from being too crowded. So, the rich will then continue their journey through the city on their litters, which will be carried by slaves. Meanwhile, the guards will search the contents of traders' carts, in order to charge the relevant duties, called the portorium. This was usually somewhere between 2 and 5% of the value of the goods, and they had the right to search everyone except married women. This portorium, as well as most travel and trade in the Empire, was a money-making machine, and a lot of the funds went to an early attempt of a welfare state, like the grain dole. This, in theory, handed out free food to the poor, and initially it was just grain, but in recent years, olive oil, bread, and even some meats were given out to over 200,000 inhabitants of Rome from over 100 distribution centres. However, don't expect to just enter the city and enjoy a free ride. To collect the dole requires a ticket, and most people didn't have one. Single women, for instance, couldn't get one at all, and many poor people sold them to the rich in times of desperation. These rich people would in turn pass them down through the generations, meaning you, like most inhabitants of Rome, will probably be on a waiting list of sorts. But thankfully, back in 212, Emperor Caracalla made every freeborn person in the Empire a citizen, so at least there's a chance you can get one. Until then though, you'll have to find a job, like most Romans, and importantly, understand the monetary system, which has just been revolutionized by Diocletian, who tried to stop runaway inflation by setting price controls and the likes. The money you will most likely use is a denarius. This, for simplicity's sake, we'll just treat like a modern day cent. Above that you have a laureate, the equivalent of 2 cents, a radiate would be 5 cents, going all the way up to a solidus, which would be like $10. So old coins like the ass had essentially disappeared into history. But these denominations would widely change in value over the years. For instance, in just over a decade or so, the solidus would be closer to $275 if we're keeping to the cents analogy. So in terms of jobs, you could become a baker and get 50 denarii a day. The grain dole means they're always in high demand, as ships from Egypt bring 200,000 tons of grain annually to feed Rome's population. Plus, the emperors are always happy to buy this grain for a fixed price and keep it in storage, just in case a crisis emerges. Therefore, the life of a baker is always open to you, and you'd always enjoy a little bit of food. The same could also be said if you wanted to be a sailor. Again, it's a job in high demand, and if you're on a seagoing vessel, you could get 60 denarii a day, and some form of food in the process. But sailing was very limited in the winter months, and there was always a chance that your captain had a bad dream. Dreams of black goats, for instance, were an obvious bad omen, and sailors wouldn't embark on their journey. Your captain may have also visited a horror specs, who would read the entrails of animals and give advice, or an augur, who would judge the will of the gods by studying the flights of birds. These could all determine whether you set sail or not. Plus, on the way, you may also be expected to throw hair clippings and the likes into the sea as an offering to the gods. But, of course, this didn't always work, as many ships crashed in the high winds or shallow waters of the Mediterranean. On the other hand, there was a chance of seeing the world. Obviously, Egypt was a popular port of call, but some Romans went beyond there, and even published guidebooks known as a periplus. These detailed ports in India where you would bring home pepper, one of Rome's most popular commodity. Plus, they also detailed West Africa, where you would fill up your vessels with elephants and lions, all ready to be brought back to the arenas back home. Anyway, 50 to 60 denarii is a pretty common salary for anyone with some sort of skill, like a stonemason, a blacksmith, or a lime burner. Or you could also take up a job in a barbershop and receive as much as 2 denarii per head. This would have been a fantastic opportunity for you a couple centuries ago, as you wouldn't find a beard in Rome and everybody had short hair. But now barbarian fashions are slipping across the border and more people have beards. Also, something to keep in mind, you'd need to buy your own tools, and a pair of really bad scissors could cost as much as 75 denarii. Yet, if you got skilled, you could make a great deal of money working on the incredibly elaborate hair of the wealthy ladies, who would wear their hair high in curls at the front and the back. Think somewhat similar to a pompadour. As for the men, although some have beards, it is still rare to see a mustache in Rome, as it is still the domain of the barbarians. The barbarians, by the way, would also have different types of hairstyles, so you could probably tell who is who. The Germanic Swabi tribe favoured the Swabian knot, a sort of top knot on the side of their head. The Franks wore their hair in a sort of ponytail on the top of their head and shaved the back of their necks, while the Britons enjoyed a mullet. Otherwise, another job you could take is a guard of clothes in a public bath, and you would get 2 denarii per bather. Here, at least you'll be surrounded by the luxury of the baths, but especially after they have segregated the genders, there is a lot more male prostitution going on. This is a way for people to supplement their wages, obviously, so don't feel taken aback when it will be proposed. But you may be educated and believe that you would get higher wages. However, wages are somewhat low even for the educated. An elementary teacher, for instance, could only expect to get around 50 denarii per pupil per month. You would also be required to attract your own students and set up school wherever you could. Most teachers would set up school outside, and it was common for schools to begin at dawn to avoid the large crowds, and it would continue until midday. Plus, on your salary, don't expect to use ink when teaching, as just 300 grams of it cost over 12 denarii. An elementary school teacher, or a literator, would teach reading, writing, maths, and Roman morals to the young children of Rome. So there were many demands on these teachers, but there are some upsides to their low wages, as around 10% of the city of Rome were, to some degree, literate. Beyond that, you could become a grammaticus, teaching children aged around 10 to 13 Greek, the works of Homer, and a great deal of poetry. But this would only be the children of the rich, as the poor would have sent their kids off to become an apprentice. The final stage of education was taught by a rhetor, who taught the rich students the art of public speaking, laws, and politics, or, in other words, rhetoric. One interesting little field of learning was chironomia, which was the art of hand gestures in speech. So, if you ever get the chance to see a politician or general speak, expect to see some pretty outlandish hand gestures when they try to emphasize points. To supplement your salary, you could become a scribe and charge upwards of 20 denarii per 100 lines, or you could privately tutor some rich kids. Here, you could always strike lucky and tutor a future emperor, like Ausonius did when he tutored Gratian, and he was later gifted the consulship for his efforts. Otherwise, you could test your strength and join the Roman Legion, and at the end of your service, you would receive over 5,000 denarii and a plot of farmland. But service lasted 25 years, and during this time you'll only receive around 1 denarii per day. Then you would also be charged for clothes and sometimes some of your food. A pair of shoes, for instance, cost 75 denarii, which would be around 2.5 months' wage. Soldiers would therefore be fighting for free, all with the hope that they would survive 25 years stationed on the frontiers of the empire. In the past, these soldiers would receive citizenship, but now everyone's a citizen, this benefit was also lost. So you may be wondering why some people joined. For some, they are promoted and got more pay. But even for the foot soldier, there was the possibility of bonuses throughout the year, which were paid out hoping to keep the legions loyal to the emperor. But most importantly, there was always the possibility of loot, as slaves and gold from conquered cities were distributed among the legionnaires. This is why many soldiers were more loyal to their commanders rather than the state at large. However, most of the soldiers did not volunteer. Conquered people filled the ranks, and conscription, known as dilectus, was a far more prevalent thing during this time. This required sons of soldiers to enlist, and landowners had to send recruits into the forces. But landowners often wanted to keep their strong men, so they sent off the weak to join the army. But this is just a sign of the time. Restrictions on age and height of soldiers were always being relaxed, and the legionnaires just weren't as feared as they once were. Luckily for you though, you are now in the city and exempt from the draft. So your most likely career path will be as a general labourer, picking up odd jobs when needed. But if you do find work, you'll be considered very lucky, as unemployment is on the rise, and somewhere between 10 and 15% of people are jobless. There's also another further complication. You're entering into a workforce in direct competition with slaves, who make up to one-third of the city's population. Therefore, you can only expect around 25 denarii per day. And for this salary, you could also find a job as a water carrier, a mule driver, or even a farmer outside the city. So first, with that money, you'll need to find a place to stay. Now, the Empire may have built structures that would stand for centuries, but this wasn't true for the 44,000 apartment houses. These were called insula, and were usually between 3 to 5 stories high, and they were infamously very dangerous. Cicero, for instance, complained that two of his properties just collapsed, while the rest was so close to falling that even the rats had moved out. Plus, fires would also break out in many of them, despite the efforts of the vigiles, or the Roman firefighters. This, by the way, could be another job opportunity for you, because you'll get slightly more money than someone in the legion, while also remaining in Rome. Their job was sort of a mix of firefighting and policing, and like the other police force in Rome, the urban cohorts, they were designated regions of Rome to oversee. But even though they totaled around 7,000 combined, they could do little to stop the constant fires. Also, they were often accused of looting homes while the fires were ongoing. So, if you can, fork out a little extra money and get a room on the lower floors, because you'll have a better chance to escape if it falls down or catches fire. But on your salary, you'll probably be high up, sharing a room with maybe 4 or 5 other people. Setting a price on these can be a little difficult, as it depended on cleanliness, location, and the likes. But I'd say you could find one of these places for a couple denarii a night. The slumlords who own these houses will divide up their buildings any way they like, and when choosing an apartment, pay attention to what's on the ground floor. It'll usually be a shop, and you may not want to live above the smells of a butcher's or a popina, a type of Roman bar frequented by the lower classes, slaves and prostitutes, or, as they were described by many, a den of thieves and gamblers. These apartments are also built remarkably close together, leaving the streets below in almost total darkness, and filled with the waste of the inhabitants. For the passerbys below, there was also the danger of being killed by falling pots from the windows above. They were in fact so close together that many people could look out of their window and shake hands with the person living opposite. Tacitus in fact describes them pretty well, when he says, "The peasants crowded together in their close apartments, with heat, want of sleep, and their attendance on each other, propagated the disease." So, zero privacy, no sleep, intense heat, disease, and to add on to that, the feeling of being imprisoned. Crime was so bad in the city, especially in the pitch black of night, that metal bars were put across the windows, and people built doors out of maybe 4 layers of solid board, and had a number of bolted locks to secure it. Then, behind most of the doors, a janitor guarded the house at night, usually with a dog. And on dogs, by the way, most houses would have a guard dog, chained up by the door. The most popular breed is the Vitrages, which are the ancestors of the greyhound. But many rich ladies in particular may have a Meliton, which was a fluffy lapdog similar to a Maltese. They are therefore seen as pets at least, but all was not great. Many of the mastiffs would be brought into wars, and there was an annual festival in August known as Supplica Canum, where guard dogs who had failed in their duty would be ritually sacrificed. Anyway, after sleeping in your new home, you more than likely want to get out and enjoy the city, and more than likely, enjoy a good wash. Thankfully, the baths are affordable at just 1 denarius per person. There are close to 1,000 in the city of various size, but most followed a very similar design. First, you'd leave your clothes in the apodyterium, but as mentioned before, if you want someone to watch over them, you'll need to pay. Then you'd go into the warm room, then the hot room where you may pour a little olive oil on yourself, and finally the cold room. But when choosing your bathhouse, be sure to check the water, as many don't change it regularly, and cuts often get infected or develop into gangrene. In some of the side rooms you may purchase perfumes, or if you're so inclined, have certain sexual desires met. But once again, the genders at this time are segregated. This segregation wasn't, however, true in many of the public bathrooms, where you'd all sit together, and in case you're wondering, you'd clean using a sponge on a stick. But despite the many public bathrooms, don't be surprised to see people still going out in the open or in the river. Plus, there are many chamber pots placed around the city. These were placed there by the fulo, or the laundry workers, because nothing cleans your white fabrics better than a little urine. And going back to prostitution for a bit, this needs to be discussed as they are everywhere. In the baths outside the circus in the Colosseum, and sometimes even in cemeteries. Sometimes a slave would be forced into it, but there is a growing number of poor women turning to it as well. However, any free woman who engaged in the act could lose her citizenship and many of her rights. This was called infamia, and also applied to the pimps, and weirdly, entertainers such as actors and gladiators. To attract customers in such a competitive market, client hunters may pressure men into brothels, but more often than not, clothes entice the punters inside. As blonde is the most desirable hair colour, they may use dyes or wigs made out of horse or human hair. Plus, a green pair of shoes or sash would also be an indicator, however, you could also expect to see them standing outside naked, maybe just outside your house. Yet, if this thing is for you, you could probably hire their services for around 1 denarius. They are also present, as mentioned before, at the popina, or the bars, and this will more than likely be the establishment you will go for drinks. On drinks, they can be a little pricey, especially on your salary. Half a litre of wine can cost as much as 30 denarii, depending on where it came from. But the average cost of just the regular old wine will be around 8 denarii per half litre. As for beer, Egyptian beer is the cheapest for 2 denarii per half litre, while a beer from Gaul would cost twice the price. Then, of course, you'll need to grab something to eat. But, like most people, you won't have a kitchen in your small room. So, you will probably eat at the Thermopyleums, the ancient street food vendors, which are located everywhere. One strange thing you will most likely encounter is garum, the source of the city, which is made out of fish intestines and blood, and stored for weeks. So, expect most of your dishes to be a little bit pungent, and this, by the way, would cost 12 denarii per half litre. This is the same price as olive oil, and half the price of honey. But a cheaper option is vinegar, which would cost just 8 per half litre. Salt, on the other hand, is 5 denarii per kilo, which is surprisingly cheap compared to the price of it in later centuries. The cheapest food for you will be oats, which cost just over 1 denarius per kilo. But for 2 denarii, you could also get half a kilo of chickpeas or lentils, so expect to eat a lot of them. As for fruits and veg, for 1 denarii you could get 10 apples, 1 watermelon, or 300 grams of cherries. For 2 to 3 you could get a cabbage, some apricots, beets, turnips or cucumber, or even a couple dozen hazelnuts or chestnuts. As for meat, pork is pretty expensive at 12 denarii per 300 grams. But the meat is actually cheaper than the feet, stomach and liver, which all cost around 20 for the same weight. The most expensive part of the pig though is a little delicacy, the sow's womb, which will cost you over 24 denarii. As for other strange delicacies, 10 dormice would cost you 40 denarii, so close to 2 days' salary, while 100 sea urchins cost 50, and a peacock is 300, so maybe these are treats for those special occasions. Now you may be thinking there are cheaper meat options like chicken, but you'd be wrong. One chicken would cost you 30 denarii, and an egg would cost you 1. This means a couple eggs are worth an hour's work, and a chicken is a day's salary. There is a good reason for this, as hens are not as intensively farmed, and don't produce 1 egg per day like they would in later centuries. Rabbit is also strangely expensive at 40 for 1, and 1 skinny goose is 100, but expect to pay double that if you want some meat on the bones. However, there are cheaper options for meat. For 8 denarii, you could get 300 grams of beef, a fish from the river, 80 large snails, or 5 sparrows. A duck, on the other hand, would be more expensive at 20, and a turtle dove would cost 12. So if you eat out, like most people, expect oats to be a pretty common meal, as you can get it for just a couple denarii, depending of course on the location. Yet, if you are going to attend a feast with all the rich people of Rome, it's important to note that most of them ate their meals lying down, as they believe it encourages digestion. Now you've got your place to stay, and you've eaten. Now you of course need to dress like a local. You may expect a toga will be the best choice, but they were incredibly costly, awkward to put on, unwieldy to wear, and a nightmare to clean. So they've now largely been replaced by the tunic, and these tunics are becoming more ornate, even among the poor. This means the plain white clothes have gone, and now the city is filled with reds, yellows, and greens. Plus, each tunic will have a pattern on it, like the orbiculum circles. Underneath the tunic, more men are wearing trousers than ever before. These used to be seen as the clothes of the enemy, worn by the Persians and even European barbarians. But now the empire and military is being filled with these former enemies, so this change was inevitable. Women's clothes are equally colourful, and for ladies, there's a new development in the bikini, which is worn by women when doing sports. However, none of these clothes will be cheap. A short cloak will cost you around 500 denarii, but if you want a hood on it, then it'll cost you 1,500. And that's the cheapest one you can find from Africa. One from Britain will cost you 6,000, and from Austria over 10,000 if you want a cloak with a hood. A tunic, on the other hand, without any decorations, would cost you 2,000 as well. Shoes are thankfully more affordable at 100 denarii, while a leather belt is 80. But that's still a few months of work to get all of your clothes. However, strangely, while fabrics are expensive, animal furs are not. A lynx or wolf fur, for instance, would cost you 40, and a bear only 150. So maybe you could break from the mold and wear furs like a barbarian. And just to give you a little idea on the wealth disparity, silk clothes would cost tens of thousands of denarii, with silk dyed purple being the most expensive at 150,000. As for other goods you may need, soap is around 12 denarii per 300 grams, a shovel and a candle for those dark nights will cost you around 4 each, yet if you want to get into farming, a goat is 400, a cow is 2,000, and a horse is 10,000. A small wooden wagon without any iron would cost you over 800, and even something as mundane as a sack for a mule would cost over 100 denarii, or, to rent, 2 denarii per day. So now you've eaten and got dressed, it's time for a bit of fun, and luckily there's a bunch of holidays, hundreds in fact. For instance, August and December have around 12 or 13 each. Possibly the best is Saturnalia in December, which was a rowdy time of carnivals and parties. Plus, there was a tradition to swap roles, and a king of Saturnalia was crowned. So expect to see slaves shouting at their masters. Or in May there's Floralia, the fertility festival. Here theatre performances were put on, people collect and wear flowers, and like on all holidays, usually some games are held. Plus you may even get lucky and catch a tightrope walking elephant. But one for the women to probably avoid is Lupercalia in mid-February. This festival begins with the sacrifice of a goat and a dog, and then men would run naked round the streets. Sometimes they would slap women's hands as a means to encourage fertility, but expect the crowds to get somewhat violent and a little bit sexually aggressive. Otherwise, as the Roman workday was somewhat short, beginning at dawn and ending in the early afternoon, you will have a lot of time to enjoy yourself. Most of the citizens are keen sportsmen, so if you're a man at least, you could go swim with them in the Tiber or pools, maybe even wrestle them at the Palaestra, go fishing, or even have a foot race. There are even new games like Latrun Cooley, which is their version of chess, or Turni Lapilli, their version of tic-tac-toe. These are played in bars, public areas, or even on the floors of the city. Better yet, you could go and explore the city, which is pretty easy to navigate as it's only 5 kilometers or so from the east to the west. Yet Rome is still divided up into 14 regions, and these are all subdivided into various vicars. At the center of all of these would be a crossroads, where there'll be a communal shrine to spirits known as the Lares. These would be the center of life and community. So as a recent immigrant, you'll be more at home in Trans-Tiberium, which is cut off from the rest of Rome by bridges filled with beggars and criminals. Think of it as the wrong side of the tracks. Many people from the eastern parts of the empire live here, and they face a lot of discrimination, despite what many people say about Rome being multicultural. People like Juvenal blame them for tearing apart the morals of Rome, and describe these Syrians as effeminate, sneaky, and born to be slaves. But the term Syrian is pretty broad, and was used to describe people from the Middle East, Cyprus, and beyond, including the growing number of Jews and Christians. So here you'll find statues of eastern gods like Baal from Palmyra, alongside a number of early churches and synagogues. Yet, I'd recommend not associating with the Christians. This year, 303 AD, marks the beginning of the great Diocletian persecution, and many thousands will be killed, including Saint George over in Turkey. This isn't even the only religion that Diocletian persecuted, as a few years ago, he all but wiped out Manichaeism, a religion born out of Persia, which spread from Rome to China. So if you are a Christian, I'd say just wait a couple decades until Constantine makes it the state religion. Leaving your area, cross the Pons Probi, a recently built bridge. Passing by the beggars, you'll be crossing over the River Tiber, a pretty polluted river. Thankfully though, the many aqueducts bring fresh water into the city and to the castellums. From there, through underground piping, a descent to industries, baths, and many public fountains which are free to drink from. The largest of the public fountains are in Nymphiums, buildings dedicated to nymphs. So if you do get thirsty, try and track them down. If you were to go south from here, you'd see huge warehouses like the Emporium. These could house millions of sacks of grain, barrels of wine and olive oil, and tons of granite and marble. Then, just behind these warehouses, you can see a pretty strange landmark that has been created by the sheer volume of trade. This is called Monte Testaccio. Now, because olive oil was imported in jars that couldn't be reused, they had to build this mountain, which is over 150 feet tall, just to throw away all these broken jars. Plus, also in the south, you could see the Pyramid of Cestius, but this pales in comparison to those in Egypt, as it stands less than 30 meters high. So I'd say just head north. There, pretty much straight away, you'll come to the Circus Maximus, which could house close to 300,000 incredibly rowdy chariot racing fans. This has in fact become more popular than the Gladiator Games, and thankfully it's free to attend, as only those who wanted seats in the shade needed to pay. You'd meanwhile be stood in the sun, packed among hundreds of thousands of people. There are races here on 66 days of the year, and on each of those days, there would be over 20 races. The charioteers would perform somewhere between 5 to 7 laps of the track, while sporting their team colours, blue, red, white or green. These teams would have their own supporters, and they established factions which fought in the stands. So essentially hooligans. Eventually over in Constantinople they'd become political and lead to the Nicar riots of the 6th century. So prepare for a pretty hectic atmosphere. These supporters didn't just keep their anger in the stands either. They'd throw curse amulets onto the tracks, hoping to magically give their side the advantage. And sometimes they'd put nails in the amulets, just for good measure. Many charioteers therefore died in crashes, but it could be worth the risk. One racer, for instance, named Gaius Apuleius Diocles, collected over 26,000 kilograms of gold. This would make his net worth somewhere in the billions. Once the races are over, exit the stadium at the south, go beyond the throngs of beggars, prostitutes, and people peddling their food, and continue south. There you'll come to the huge baths of Caracalla, which has 7 pools, its own library, and a number of beautiful statues. But just on statues quickly. These, like the mosaics, were remarkably colourful. Nothing like what the bland Renaissance artists would try to emulate. So you could spend hours in the baths of Caracalla. But I'd say head north, back up the Palatine Hill, just in front of the racing tracks, where you'll find the Grand Palaces, which used to be the residence of past emperors, like the House of Augustus. But don't expect to see an emperor here today. Rome is just the ceremonial capital, and the emperors are choosing more strategic centers to rule from, like in Milan, or Diocletian is currently constructing a huge palace over in Split in Croatia. But one building here you should pay attention to is the Septizodium. This was built over 100 years ago, but it's just a decorative facade and has no real purpose. It was merely built to impress visitors. After looking at the palaces just on your right, if you continue north, you'll find the Colosseum, where, as I'm sure you know, people would engage in the blood sports in front of tens of thousands of people. For you, you could go and see the games for free, providing you got hold of the little coin-like coupons they handed out. but I'd recommend getting there early to avoid the crowds. Back in the glory days, thousands of gladiators fought each other or against thousands of animals during certain celebrations. This demand wiped out a number of animals from Turkey and North Africa, driving traders further south along the African coast. And to give you some ideas on the cost of running these things, a single lion would cost over 100,000 denarii. Plus, sometimes the floor was flooded to host huge mock sea battles, so they were therefore heavily promoted and big business. Plus, they were also used as a political tool for some leaders. Sometimes this backfired, however, like at the games Pompey held, when people cursed him because they felt sorry for the elephant crying out in sadness. Fortunately or unfortunately, the games are not as big these days. The lack of manpower during the 3rd century crisis meant people were better put to use on the battlefields, but they do still continue. The gladiators will train nearby in the Ludus Magnus, where they would eat a vegetarian diet of boiled beans and oatmeal, and they trained in a certain speciality. A retiarius, for instance, would train with a net, or a cestus was a boxer who fought with iron gloves, and could almost kill a man with one punch. A lot of the old gladiator types have been retired, like the Mirmillo, which was based on the Gauls of northern Italy. Plus, so too have the female gladiators, who often betrayed the Amazons and the likes. Some of the slaves who performed in the games became celebrities and highly desirable partners to some of the ladies, but they were seen by many as the lowest class, on par with actors and prostitutes, and their average life expectancy was just 27. The few thousand cohorts would have a tough time keeping crowds in order on game days, but when you leave, take a left from the Colosseum, and now you're in the true center of city life, the Forum, which is filled with many temples and monuments. You'll pass by the Arch of Titus, built to honor the emperor's victory in Jerusalem. Beyond that is the Temple of Julius Caesar, who, like many emperors, had been deified. Inside that temple, you can see a religious cult based around a comet, as one appeared in the sky after Caesar was killed. Nearby is the Regia, the old home of the kings of Rome from centuries ago. But another great temple worth a look at is the Temple of Vesta, the goddess of the hearth and home. Now you can't go inside, but you might be able to catch a glimpse of the Vestal Virgins, women who swore a vow of chastity for 30 years. They took part in many public ceremonies and were actually considered to be magical, with the ability to stop runaway slaves in their tracks. On the other hand, if someone had been enslaved or condemned to death, the touch of a Vestal Virgin would free them. So this life could be a good choice for ladies from poor families. Their main job was to make sure that the eternal fire of Vesta was lit at all times, as it was seen as the flame of Rome and the emperors. If it went out, the virgin on duty would receive beatings. But the worst crime was breaking the vow of celibacy, and the guilty would have been buried alive in a ditch outside Porta Colina in the east of the city. But these weren't the only body of religious people you can meet in the Forum. You could also see the Arval Brethren, who were tasked with making annual sacrifices to ensure a good harvest. Another temple you should go and see is the Temple of Saturn, which doubled as a bank. So, while visiting the temple, join others and make an offering in the hopes that you too will achieve some sort of financial stability. There you could offer an animal sacrifice, or, like most people, just a libation would do, which was essentially pouring oil or wine onto the floor. Nearby is the Basilica Julia, which is a popular meeting point. Many people will go shopping there or play games on the floor, similar to checkers, while upstairs there are law courts, mainly dealing with inheritance and the likes. Outside, in the center of the Forum, is the Rostra, a platform for speeches. Here you could receive news from the Empire, or this year is also when Diocletian will come to Rome for the first time, and there will be a great deal of pomp and ceremony to honor him. The Forum is also home to the Tullianum, a prison for some of the most high-ranking criminals or enemies of Rome. So, defeated leaders would be brought here during a triumph and thrown in their underground cells. Like for all prisoners of Rome, conditions were awful, often worse than the executions themselves, as prisoners would be tortured into confessing and could go years without seeing the sun. But the state prisons were mainly for people who received the death penalty, while debtors were often thrown into private prisons. While, generally for the poor, vigilante justice was the usual course of action, meaning crimes would often spiral out of control into some sort of blood feud. Back on ground level, remember that this is a forum, or in other words, a marketplace. So you can find a huge pepper warehouse, called a Horia Pepitaria. This feeds the city's almost unquenchable thirst for pepper. Many Romans actually have got a little bit worried about the demand, as silver and gold is leaving the empire in vast quantities and being sent to India in return for pepper. But this trade deficit seems unlikely to end anytime soon, as Apicius's cookbook recommends using pepper on 75% of his dishes, and it was also used in medicines. It's been said to cure some eye diseases, hot pepper could cure a cold, and mix it with honey and apply it to sheep to encourage them to mate. Yet these are probably the most pleasant of cures, as if you had acne, then you'd put crocodile meat on your face, seahorses cured incontinence, leave a wolf's gallbladder on your stomach to cure constipation, put a chameleon in wine and apply it to your head to cure a headache, or to cure gout, you could boil a live fox and drink the water, or have a menstruating woman touch you. Both will work. One of their cures you may have even heard of, hair of the dog. This comes from the idea that if a rabid dog bites you, you need to take some part of the dog and apply it to the wound. This could be hair, but Pliny recommends the ashes from a dead dog's skull, a maggot from the dog, tail hair, or even the dog's menstrual blood if it's a lady dog. So best just try not to get ill. Anyway, as you walk through the forum, on your right you'll see the Curia, the old home of the Roman Senate. But now it's mainly just concerned with running the city. At the end of the forum you'll see another government building, the Tabularium, where more officials work, storing thousands of mundane documents. If you take a right, you'll come to the entrance of Trajan's Forum. This was built with the spoils of the Dacian Wars, so you can see statues of soldiers everywhere, even above the huge archway entrance. Going through, there is a huge basilica made out of marble, Trajan's Column and libraries that flank it, plus most visitors are very impressed by the enormous statue of Trajan himself, sat on horseback and cast in bronze. Yet, despite all of this grandeur, it is still a forum, so there are a number of market stalls scattered around. But I'd say leave Trajan's Forum and head south along the Street of Yokemakers. As you walk down here, you'll see the Temple of Jupiter Optimus Maximus on your right. This is probably the most important temple in the city, as many past emperors would have made their sacrifices here. So it's well worth a visit, but truly there are hundreds of temples, shrines and holy sites that you can go to. So continue south, you can do quite a bit of shopping around here. You'll first come to the Market of Vegetable Sellers, but you'll have to pass through the cursed gate of Porta Carmentalis in the old city walls. The stories say way back in the 5th century BC, Romans left through this gate before being defeated by the Etruscans at Cremara. But it is also where the dead were taken through to be buried in the old cemetery outside the city. So many Romans in the old days would avoid leaving from this gate. Anyway, after the vegetable market, you could go to the cattle market in front of Tiber Island. Or there's a wine market near the Pyramid of Cestius, or there's a fish market back in the main forum. But on your day off, I'd say just continue past the vegetable market, and on your left you'll come to the Theatre of Marcellus, which could seat around 17,000 people. Here the actors will keep to the two main genres of tragedy and comedy. And even within that, many of the plays follow a very similar format. For instance, you'll more than likely see a play that centres around a young unmarried man named an adolescence. He will get into all sorts of trouble after falling in love with a slave girl who is known as a Virgo. But just as the play ends, it will be revealed that she is in fact a freeborn and the two people can get married. Now, just to get you prepared for some of the comedy, I can share a few jokes with you that have been collected from the joke books or scrawled on city walls. An intellectual bought a pair of pants, but he could hardly put them on because they were too tight, so he got rid of the hair around his legs. When an intellectual was told by someone, "Your beard is coming in," he went to the rear entrance and waited for it. Another intellectual asked, "How do you know that it is not coming by the other gate?" So maybe these jokes aren't to your taste, but the plays are often free. Just remember to get your tokens early once again. Carry along the Tiber and you'll come to the Theatre of Pompey, which has a huge garden in front of it. And within the complex, there's the old Curia in which Caesar was assassinated, so maybe worth a little trip. Or you could take a right up the road and go to the Circus Flaminius. This also held chariot events, yet nothing compared to the Circus Maximus. But they did host events like the Taurian Games, which happened every few years in honour of the Dii Inferi, or the gods below. Further along the river you'll come to Navalia, the military docks. Here, emperors would return from their battles and begin their triumph around the city. So back in the glory days, people would have lined the banks celebrating the successes of the likes of Trajan. Then the emperors would march their soldiers and conquered foes to the Circus Maximus, through the Forum, and onto the Temple of Jupiter. Continue along the Via Tecta, you will arrive at two bridges leading out of the city. On crossing the river, you will first come to Hadrian's Mausoleum, and eventually morph into the Castle St. Angelo in Christian times. Plus, there's more circuses, Hadrian's and Nero's. Nero's may be worth a visit because it was said to be where St. Peter and many early martyrs were killed. So, this area would become the site of St. Peter's tomb, and then the seat of the Catholic Church. So, if you're Christian, maybe pay your respects here. After that, re-enter the city, passing the guards once again, and head east. You'll find another stadium, the Stadium of Domitian, and yet another great bathhouse, the Baths of Nero. Next year, at the Stadium of Domitian, you can witness the execution of St. Agnes, who, allegedly, magically blinded her would-be rapists. She will be sentenced to burn, but the fire wouldn't light, so she will just be beheaded in front of the crowds at the circus, or so the story goes. But now you're in the Campus Martius, the Fields of Mars, where there are yet even more grand buildings like the Temple of Hadrian, the Column of Marcus Aurelius, and a great deal more. Nero's wooden amphitheatre once stood here, where he hosted so many games that there were no more criminals left to kill, so he made 400 senators fight soldiers. On the left you'll be able to see an obelisk stolen from Egypt, and it is today used as a giant sundial. In front of it stands the beautifully decorated Altar of Peace, where you may be able to see animals being led inside to be sacrificed to the gods. But the most famous site on the Fields of Mars is the Pantheon. This building was the site of speeches given by emperors in order to fill their listeners with the feeling of the divine. There they would stand surrounded by huge statues of the gods and past emperors underneath a huge dome, which is an engineering marvel you should very well see. Just in front of the Pantheon you'll find one of the huge slave markets in the city, while you could have seen another one back in front of the Temple of Castor and Pollux in the Forum. Here slaves will stand on raised platforms with signs over their necks, giving details about them. Age, place of birth, skills, that sort of thing. A male aged between 16 and 40 would go for around 25 denarii, while a woman would be 20,000. A young boy aged less than 8 would cost 15,000, and a girl just 10. But of course these prices would vary greatly, depending on place of birth and skills. Like those who were able to write could fetch a higher price, and the Greeks in particular were prized slaves. Britons on the other hand were said to be the worst, because of their inability to write before music, and generally just being a bit too barbarian. Now these prices may seem high, but a worker on 25 denarii a day would set the rich back 9,000 per year. So within just over 2 years, they made their money back. Continuing east from here, take a right at the Temple of Neptune, and you'll see the Scepter Julia, where centuries ago, during the Republican period, people would gather to cast their votes. But now it's just a huge public space connected to the Baths of Agrippa. Rather than re-entering the chaos of the city, keep heading east, past the Temple of Serapis, a strange god who came from Egypt, but was really a weird mix between Greek and Egyptian gods. Continue east and you'll come to workers building the Great Baths of Diocletian, which will be open in a couple of years. Plus, along the outskirts of the city, you can find a number of pleasure gardens. Although many have been subdivided by the rich and turned into villas, you can still go to the Gardens of Sallust. Here you can see yet another circus, and some fantastic artwork, like the Dying Gaul, and the Sleeping Hermaphroditus. After that, continue east towards the outskirts of the city, and you'll reach the barracks of the Praetorian Guards, the kingmakers of Rome. They killed many emperors like Caligula, and these barracks are the site of the assassination of Elagabalus a century ago. Plus, during the year of five emperors, Didius Julianus just promised the guards more money, so they proclaimed him emperor. But see it while you can, as it will not last long. When Constantine rides south into Italy, he will disband the Praetorians, and they would be defeated at the Battle of Milvian Bridge in 312. A bridge which is located just north of the city. Yet by now it will be getting dark, and it's best to go back before the city is plunged into total darkness and criminals roam the street. You, unlike the rich, don't have slaves to hold lanterns for you, or you're not protected by guards. So head back, past the circuses and bathhouses, through the forums, go by the theatres and across Tiber Island, trying to avoid the beggars on the bridges, back into your immigrant community, back into your dilapidated apartment, which is guarded by janitors, and up to your shared bedroom, where you will sleep, hoping not to catch a disease, ready to be up at the crack of dawn to carry water or lug produce around the city for 25 denarii a day.